Hello, welcome. I'm delighted to welcome you to Policy Exchange this evening. Thank you so many for coming for this event on the future of drugs policy. One of the pleasures of working for a think tank is that you get to think up events that you'd like to see happen, think up interesting speakers that you'd like to hear talk about a particular debate, and obviously organise debates on the topics that you're most interested in. And so tonight we have the event on drugs policy, and we have two very fine speakers who will be chatting about this important subject. So I'd just like to introduce Dr. Kevin Sabet, has advised three US presidential administrations, Clinton, Bush Jr., and indeed most recently President Obama, where he served on the White House Office of National Drug Control Policy. He's the only drug policy staffer to have ever served as a political appointee in both Democrat and Republican administrations. He runs a volunteer-driven, independent, bipartisan campaign group called Smart Approaches to Marijuana. This group seeks a drug policy which is based on the clear scientific evidence about the use of marijuana. He's written a widely acclaimed book called Reefer Sanity, Seven Great Myths About Marijuana. He has a regular blog at the Huffington Post, and he writes op-eds for major newspapers, primarily in America. Two of these columns actually earned him a Five Best Columns distinction by The Atlantic magazine. We also have Victoria Atkins MP, who was elected in 2015 to represent Louth and Horncastle. She has been appointed to the Home Affairs Select Committee. She had a very successful legal career prior to entering politics. And I guess her specialism in terms of tonight is that she was involved as a criminal barrister in prosecuting serious organised crime before entering Parliament. So she's actually prosecuted international drug trafficking rings, gun runners and fraudsters. She is one of only 30 advocates in England and Wales appointed to the Attorney General's regulator panel and the Serious Fraud Office's list of specialist fraud prosecutors. So thank you, Kevin, and thank you, Victoria, and we look forward to a very interesting discussion.
Glenn, I'll give you a chance to get to your seat. Dr. Sabet, it is wonderful to have you here tonight, particularly because this evening, across the road, the House of Commons will be voting on the second stage of the Psychoactive Substances Bill, where we get to debate about all the new legal highs, as they're called, coming onto the market, and I'll ask you about that in due course. But we've just heard your fantastic CV, and I've got to ask, given that we're here in Westminster in the centre of politics, how on earth have you persuaded both Democrats and Republicans to listen to you?
First question. You know, I think that when you're sort of your guide here is using the evidence and using the science, people really of all parties are interested in that. And sort of, I actually lived not too far from here for 3 or 4 years and got my DPhil here at Oxford, and that's sort of where I honed a lot of this. And I think actually that's probably not my best achievement. My best achievement might be we left that out of the bio, but I headed a group called Citizens for a Drug-Free Berkeley. I know. It was about as popular as the Coalition for a Wine-Free France, I think. So that was probably more of a feat than Republican and Democrat. I mean, at the end of the day, actually, I don't think, in all seriousness, this isn't something that should be a partisan issue, really. I mean, if I could say that. I think that folks of all political stripes are interested in reducing harms, reducing prevalence. It's very hard to make a case that more drugs are good for any community. And so, you know, if that's sort of where you're going, obviously how you get there is where the debate lies. But I think people are interested in that.
And indeed, you've touched upon it already, that the discussion around drugs in this country, and I imagine the states, is tends to be between people who are pro-legalization and those who are against it. Where do you stand?
I mean, I'm obviously very clear to be against it, you know, but I also think we need to avoid extremes in the debate and the discussion. I'm actually seeing, you know, above you, I see preventing extremism as one of the pillars. I understand it's about something else, but it sort of it goes along with kind of the overall sort of general view that, you know what, if a policy fits on a bumper sticker, it's probably not a good one. And what I've seen is that we've had this push and pull of legalization or incarceration, a sort of war on drugs. And I was noticing when I was at the White House this last time, this really heavily bifurcated debate where either you are in favor of throwing people in prison for long amounts for drugs, or you were in favor of legalizing. And I think there are many other things that frankly work. I think what actually works is what's in between. And in my mind, what's in between is, look, we don't want to give people criminal records for, you know, trying cannabis or for having a small amount on them. We don't want to destroy their life so that when they're trying to get a job somewhere, this comes up on the docket. But at the same time, we are in the midst, both in the UK and the US, of slamming the door on another industry which deceived all of our people for almost a century by saying that their substance was harmless, didn't cause problems, wasn't addictive, and frankly should be made more available. And you all know what I'm talking about with the tobacco industry. It is especially ironic to me that as we are sort of licking our wounds from 100 years of systematic lies, that we are slamming the door on the tobacco industry and opening the back door and rolling out the red carpet for the cannabis industry, which is what we're doing in the US right now. That to me makes no sense. I mean, you probably know, Victoria, we knew about the link with tobacco and lung cancer, and we've actually known about that since the early 1920s, okay? It was by an industry who lives off of addiction for their profit, frankly, hidden, obscured, and I see that happening with cannabis. I see sort of like, well, we're not really sure if there's such thing as addiction. You know, we're not really sure if there's a mental illness even link. And, you know, there's a lot of other factors. We're not sure where this is going. And actually, the science is clear. And so that's sort of why I felt like we needed to translate science into language that people could understand. Which is not always what scientists are doing. And I, all due respect for, I mean, you have great researchers here in the UK, including people like Mr. Forty, people like Robin Murray, many others who are doing groundbreaking research that is quoted all over the world. But that doesn't get translated often and doesn't get out to the wider population, and I worry about that. What does get translated and out to the wider population is when a kid Googles cannabis, is cannabis safe, is it good for you, and sees what, frankly, the industry and the lobby make sure it comes up first on Google searches. So what I wanted to do was get rid of this dichotomy and get the science out there to have a more nuanced conversation about something that is nuanced. I mean, addiction is a complex, drug use is any drug, is a complex, what I really say is a biobehavioral disorder. It shares some aspects of things like diabetes and hypertension, but not all of them. It's not exactly a health issue like that, because unless people do this here, I don't know, I haven't heard, you don't lie to your mom, break into a car, and commit crime to get money to buy a chocolate bar if you have diabetes, right? It's not exactly the same thing. So you have to look at it in a more nuanced way.
And I always used to argue in court in my early days, when I was trained to be a barrister, when I was a junior barrister, I would be sent along to magistrates' courts and youth courts, sadly, to look after people that had ended up in the courts because of their drug addiction. Very often, actually, their use of marijuana, which had then led to psychotic episodes. And I used to describe addiction as a three-pronged attack on a person. It's physical addiction to the substance. It's a mental addiction, particularly with the harder drugs. You think, I need my next hit. And it's also a social addiction, because if you are, particularly with the harder drugs, if you're buying your raps, your hits, you tend to be socializing with other people that are doing the same, or you're relying on your dealers to do that. And I think it's refreshing to hear that people are thinking out there about not just the physical addiction, but also the social and the mental side effects as well.
Absolutely, and to your brain, addiction is addiction. Your brain, we have these complex definitions. Well, is it substance use disorder? Is it you're using DSM-5, DSM-4, addiction, dependence, what's the difference? It's very simple. You did something, the reward center in your brain realized it really liked what you did. You remembered that you did it because it hit the memory part of your brain, and you did it again despite the consequences. We have all had that in some respect. I mean, this morning it was for me, should I take the second croissant or not? I know I shouldn't, but I remembered that I really liked it, and it was sort of hot and nice. It was kind of like, ugh, what do I do? And, you know, that obviously we can laugh at, but, you know, when we're talking about drugs that artificially increase our pleasure center, we get pleasure from, thank God, I mean, we have to, we survive off of pleasure, off of all sorts of things, right? Food, sex, seeing a nice piece of art, accomplishing something, right? We like that, it's a motivator, we like it, we like doing that. When you look at any drug of abuse, we increase that pleasure center so out of whack from anything that would be natural that it is very difficult to sometimes come back. Now, people do recover. I don't think we talk about recovery nearly enough like we should. But this is why, this is what's happening in our brain that I think we need to get more grips on.
And you're co-founder of the campaign group we've heard about, Smart Approaches to Marijuana, Sam. What does it campaign for?
Well, I mean, the thing, the real reality was I was ready after three different stints in government service to, you know, sort of go into academia and write, you know, hope to write a paper that three other people would read. That was gonna be great. And the reality was, because from what I was seeing out there with the science and what was happening, I felt like we needed something. And I said, you know, this is so much oftentimes a partisan issue, as I just said it shouldn't be. In fact, as we speak, the prime negative example in my mind of partisanship or unfortunate example is happening with the Canadian election right now, because you have had this total, really shouldn't have been, bifurcation in terms of pro and anti-legalization that's happening right now as they vote in Canada. And I think that's very unfortunate. And so I said to myself, I gotta find the most liberal person I know and the most conservative person I know to stand up and sort of cancel out the partisanship. And so, Ted Kennedy's son, Patrick, was a congressman I'd worked with pushing better known as Obamacare. We were trying to do it so that people with addictions could actually get coverage for once in the US, because I know you do it better here, but you know, it took our Congress 100 years to admit that the brain is part of the body. And when I say that is, we always were saying, we'll cover people for everything from the neck down. Bad knee, bad hip, we got you covered. But something going on up here, we made this very odd segregation and said, oh, you just kind of need to get over that. You know, go to the church basement and be quiet, you'll get over it. And we didn't take it as a health issue. So he was one of my heroes because he pioneered the Mental Health Parity and Addiction Equity Act, which forces insurance companies to treat any mental illness just like a physical illness, which was groundbreaking. And he did it in a bipartisan way. That was a model for me. You know, how do you get, you know, George Bush, it was the last thing that he signed when he left office. No one ever wrote about it. An addiction mental health signed by George Bush and pushed by, you know, the son of the liberal lion of the Senate, right, a Kennedy. And I saw that was a successful model. So I said, we'll do that. And he was the person to go to, having been in early in his own recovery, his own struggles with mental health and addiction. And then I said, all right, well, we got that covered. Now I got to find the most conservative person I know. Unfortunately, Dick Cheney didn't return my phone calls. So I had to go to Plan B. And I said, well, if we can get the guy that, you know, used to write those speeches, right? That guy's probably got to be pretty good on this. And he was, and he actually approached me after seeing me on television, and we formed a friendship, and that was David Frum, right, who's of course part of this as well, a policy exchange. And I don't know if David and Patrick agree on anything else, but it doesn't matter. If they agree on this issue, that actually makes this a more powerful point. So we got both a conservative and a liberal to stand together and basically stand up and say, listen, we have to get the science out. And by the way, and this is really the overall driving motivation of my work, we have to make folks aware about this new industry. That this is not about hippies and flower children. You know, the days of, you know, bongo drum, I mean, I can say that because I went to Berkeley undergraduate, okay? The days of bongo drums at Berkeley, of cannabis representing, you know, anti-war sentiments, those are over. I know that there are still some around, God bless them. But that's not the point of cannabis legalization. The point is to make a small number of people very rich. And frankly, those people don't look like hippies with hemp t-shirts on. They look like me, they look like you. They have Ivy League MBAs. Right? They have billion-dollar business models that they're implementing. And I think we associate cannabis as sort of this underground hippie drug, which that maybe might be its origin. But we have to be very clear that the folks driving this, why you're seeing what you're seeing across the pond, across the other way of the pond, is happening because of this new industry. And so who better than a, you know, pretty liberal guy, pretty conservative guy, and then we worked with all the major medical associations, the scientific groups, to get the word out as well, because, you know, I told them, with all due respect, the average American isn't the, nighttime reading isn't exactly the annals of the Journal of the American Medical Association, page 746, footnote 20. I mean, that's not getting out there. And so we have to work with scientific groups to spread their message further to the average person.
And how are you achieving that?
Well, we don't have the billionaires on our side, so it's difficult to achieve it. We don't have the million-dollar megaphone, frankly, that the legalization spent. They just spent $9 million on an off-year election to legalize in two pretty rural states, Alaska and Oregon. So there's a lot of money there. There's a lot of interest there. There's a lot of money to be made, so it makes sense that there would be money there. And so we're doing it modestly through, we have a website that's become increasingly popular called learnaboutsam.org. Learn About Sam. It has tons of resources on it. We're doing briefings in Capitol Hill and Congress. We're going to every state capitol. We're sort of quietly behind the scenes stopping some of the legalization legislation going forward. But we're also doing, hundreds and hundreds of education seminars around the U.S., also around the world, talking about the U.S. example, trying to educate people. So really education, awareness, et cetera.
And is it really that organized in the states, the pro-legalization?
Well, I'd say it's pretty organized everywhere. I don't think it's just the states. But, 40 years ago, this started as, kind of free the weed, let's decriminalize, and has since evolved into, wait a minute, why would we ever want to decriminalize? We can make a lot of money by legalizing the sale of it, not just decriminalizing it. And, how do we do that? And so it's been a systematic campaign for 30 years, starting with medical marijuana. Right? How can something be bad for you if it's good for you, right? As the driving philosophy. And then going forward to the war on drugs has failed, everyone doesn't like it, it's terrible. So therefore the alternative to the war on drugs must be something that can, cure cancer, get rid of gangs, and fund our schools. And that's what cannabis has promised to do. Can you imagine that? Cure cancer, get rid of gangs, and fund our schools. It's a miracle drug. We didn't know it.
Amazing.
It's amazing. Yeah, but so that's sort of the progression and way that it's now been pushed.
Just because I don't know about others in the room, but I'm not aware of such an organized, well-funded campaign here in the UK. I mean, we get the odd letter to a newspaper from sort of high-profile names that we recognize, but I personally wasn't aware that we have a campaign like that going on in the UK. Perhaps I'm learning tonight for the first time.
I think there's certainly a version. And I think a lot of it comes from, actually, in many in some respects, it's coming from people. The people that are really pushing it with the checkbooks and stuff, they often may not have the best of intentions because they hope to profit off of it. But I think a lot of other people, unfortunately, they're sucked into the false dichotomy. They say, oh my God, the war on drugs has failed. And so therefore, we have to go to legalization. And so some of them are probably well-intentioned. But they themselves have, I think, been victims of this sort of, there's no way to fix something, fix current policy without sort of repeating our mistakes with alcohol and tobacco. I mean, can you imagine? We're seeing two global public health disasters in alcohol and tobacco that kill more people than any other preventable disease in the world, run by industries who thrive off of irresponsible heavy use. And we're saying, we're flirting with the idea, let's create another one of those things. And it's like we didn't get enough. And I'm not saying that drug policy is perfect. I mean, I'm ashamed at the fact that we don't have treatment on demand in America. I'm ashamed at the fact that we have more people in prison, five times as many people in prison than our historical average, five times the OECD average. I'm ashamed that we've given hundreds of thousands of people a criminal record for low-level use. Let's fix that. We can fix that. But we wouldn't ever want to fix it by saying, let's mimic policies that from a health and safety point of view haven't been successful. And the only reason that, frankly, they're even there is because of their cultural history with us. I mean, when people try and compare alcohol and cannabis, I mean, it's like comparing gravity with, I don't know, the Prius, like the solar-powered car. It's something that has been, in our culture forever versus something that still is pretty new in terms of number of people using it. And maybe that's not the best analogy, but cannabis has not been used by the majority of the Western culture for 5,000 years. It's been used for a long time, but by a small small proportion of people. It does so we're sort of stuck with our legal drugs. They're here to stay and we kind of manage it. I just don't know why we'd want to add to them.
Mm. Well, I'm going to come back to more on drugs in a bit, but I'd like to talk about your book, Reefer Sanity, Seven Great Myths About Marijuana. What are the myths?
Well, first I want to say, you know, the reason it was called Reefer Sanity is because I wanted to write it in a way that, you know, we had this idea of reefer madness, right? The government is over, you know, just it's like reefer madness. Everybody thinks that if you use cannabis, you're going to become a heroin addict tomorrow, or you're going to, you know, you should be sentenced to jail forever, or you're a deviant forever. And in America, I don't know about here, I think we have a lot of trauma when it comes to that. There are a lot of people that say, you know, they say, well, I'm in favor of legalization. And I say, okay, why? Well, we had that reefer madness stuff forever, and it's not that bad. And that's the extent of the reason they're in favor of legalization. So it's because it's a rebellion from this kind of idea that we've sort of overstated the issue. And so I'm trying to take the air out of the room on that and say, listen, let's have some sanity on it. We're not saying that if you use cannabis today, you're going to become a heroin addict tomorrow. We're not saying you're going to destroy your life if you try it today. Some will, may eventually, but not the majority. We get that. And so that was the reason. And so the seven myths, the second part of the book, basically the myth that marijuana is harmless and non-addictive, that smoking marijuana is the way to receive its medical benefits. I know we may not get into detail of this, but don't get me wrong. There are medicinal benefits of cannabis, absolutely, just like there are of the opium poppy plant. Okay? We would never say legalize heroin, though, because the plant opium produces morphine. So why would we say legalize the cannabis plant to smoke it or whatever, or use it in that form? Because some components might have some medical value. So I'm all in favor of put it behind a chemist, give it to a doctor. If the science says it's there, do the research. And actually, you do have companies in the UK doing the research. It's GW Pharmaceuticals that pioneered this, right, 15 years ago and is exporting it around the world. So there are proper ways to do it. The third thing, but smoking certainly isn't it. The third thing is that our prisons, whether they're in the UK or the US, are full of nonviolent people who are only there because of their cannabis smoking. I mean, I gotta say, you have to work really hard, especially in this country, to be imprisoned for having a joint in your pocket. I mean, you know, so, well, you should tell us, and maybe your experience is different. I read The Guardian today saying that the reduction in the arrests, even in the last few years, on cannabis. So that's another myth that our prisons, if only we legalized, we could empty our prisons. You know, our prisons in the U.S. are full because of some very complex issues, some relating to drug policy, almost none relating to cannabis possession and use. And yet that's thrown out there. And then the fourth one is about the legality of alcohol and tobacco are certainly no models. Now you're testing my knowledge. It's written about 2 years
I'm going to help you.
Oh, okay, good. Thank you.
Let's pause there. So we've got four. The first one I really want to tackle is the idea that marijuana is harmless and non-addictive. In your book, you say that cannabis nowadays is 5 to 6 times stronger than in the 60s and 70s. And I have to say, purely anecdotally, from my days in the magistrates' courts and the youth courts, I remember when the Labour government tried to downgrade cannabis. And those of us who were literally at the coalface were sort of holding our hands up in the air saying, God, we've got teenagers coming through with psychotic episodes, and the one theme that's running through all this is that they smoke cannabis regularly. Now, I appreciate that's anecdotal, but that was, I remember at the time thinking, what on earth is government doing? And it's one of the reasons, in a funny sort of way, that I wanted to come into this place so I could try and, make better laws. But this idea that the stuff on the streets nowadays, that people are, the people I used to prosecute were shipping over in articulated lorries, how harmless and non-addictive is it?
Well, look, there is this notion out there, and the reality is, because of the increased potency, it's certainly not as harmless as people think. And we know it's not as addictive as something like heroin. Frankly, tobacco is more addictive than heroin even. But for the best research we have, which frankly is admittedly pretty old, 20 years ago, it's 1 in 6 16-year-olds who try it will at some point become addicted. But the misnomer that's out there, I speak to a lot of communities about this, and I heard the other day, Kevin, I know marijuana is not addictive, somebody said. And I said, really, well, what have you read? What research, or what are you referring to? And he said, no, I know it's not addictive because I use it every day. And this is the kind of, but we laugh and it's funny, but this is the stuff that gets perpetuated out there. And people think that because you're not on the ground having lost respiration, needing, you know, an immediate pump through your heart to get your breathing back, that because it's not like heroin or cocaine or methamphetamine, that for some reason it's harmless and not addictive. You know, we hear all the time, cannabis doesn't kill. Well, it's true that in the areas of the brain that cannabis affects, it doesn't affect the brain stem, which controls your breathing, right, and controls your heart, the part of your body that controls sort of heart attacks and things like that. There are no cannabis receptors there. Same thing with tobacco. You've never heard of a tobacco-related overdose either, right? There's no such thing as a death from tobacco-related overdose. But there are many people that die from tobacco indirectly through lung cancer. For cannabis, it's things like suicide, car crashes, accidents. None of those, by the way, are correlated with tobacco. In fact, tobacco has no connection to some like psychotic episodes, zero connection to car crashes, but obviously a big connection to lung cancer. So, you know, because it's grown in potency, we've increased through, frankly, breeding, genetic breeding, we've increased the THC. And the THC is the one component out of the hundreds that are in the cannabis plant. The cannabis plant is a very complex plant. Of all of them, it's THC in it that binds to the receptors that makes you high, right? And they have bred up the THC and taken out some of the other bits, as you might call it, that are actually reduce the high, things like cannabidiol, CBD. We're finding out CBD might have medicinal value for epilepsy, for example, but it doesn't get you high. You can't find it in the cannabis that you get from the street because you can only find the high THC.
I see. And another, you've touched upon the legality of alcohol and tobacco as an argument.
Yeah, sure.
The fifth myth is that legal marijuana will solve budgetary problems, which I have to say, having listened to the charter of the debate last week on the charter of budget responsibility, I have to say it was not in the Chancellor's charter. Perhaps unsurprisingly, and I'm fascinated by this idea that legalizing cannabis could solve tax problems, well, government budgetary problems.
Well, this is the hook to get the average voter, right? I mean, you're not going to get them by saying cannabis is wonderful, everybody should use it. No, you're going to get the soccer mom, as we would call it, football mom here. I don't know. You're going to get them to vote, the average person, to vote for this or to support it by saying we can tax it, regulate it. They love using the word regulate. By the way, when's the last time we regulated something really well that was an addictive commodity? I'm still waiting for the wonderful alcohol and tobacco regulation policy, right? Well, sorry,
your government. I am always a little skeptical. When I think of the people I see in court, gun-toting drug dealers, the idea that we're going to be able to regulate them, I think is ambitious,
yeah,
but
it is.
We'll...
So the point is, let's regulate it, let's tax it. And we forget that with alcohol and tobacco regulation, we spend $10 in the US, I think it's very similar figures here in Britain, for every dollar we receive in tax revenue. So I'm still waiting for alcohol and tobacco, and frankly the lottery, to be funding our schools and be the savior for all of these wonderful things in society. In reality, in Colorado, they have taxed it. They've made some money from it, except we don't know what the cost has been. There's no one counting the cost. We also have an idea that they're making a fraction of what they promised. And by the way, the little money that is there, it's not going to prevention and treatment. We're waiting for it, you know, but it's not going there. And yet the demand for treatment has skyrocketed in Colorado. If you want to open a drug treatment center, go there. The increase in use in Colorado, which a lot of this stuff couldn't be written when I wrote the first edition of my book, the second one hopefully will come out later next year, where I'm going to update it on Colorado, and we have all on our website. But you know, it has not been this rousing success that I think sometimes people like to tout. But certainly, the reason they voted for this in Colorado, it has not materialized in terms of tax revenue. Oh, and by the way, it's a speck in the overall ocean of budget in terms of the numbers. I mean, the idea that $80 million, whatever it's been in the last 2 years, you know, is something significant. Even the New York Times, I invite you to read April in the New York Times. New York Times is fully in favor of legalization for social justice reasons, which I don't know if we're gonna tackle tonight. But they even admitted on page 2 in their April, one of their April papers, they said marijuana won't save state budgets. And they talked about how this is just a joke to say that it's actually gonna be something. And by the way, if you do it for the money reason, then on the other hand, it's a double-edged sword. You're supporting heavy user. You're basically saying, we want to fund schools, so then we need to increase not only use, very problematic use. And I also think that's problematic.
And the, admittedly, with the harder drugs, the thing I never understand as well about the regulation argument is that that would then involve UK government negotiating with, for example, Colombian drug lords, because we can't grow cocaine in this country. So how are we to access the cocaine market unless our government were to...
And the idea that the drug lords are going to also go away, right? The idea that they're going to go, I mean, let's how do they make their money? They don't... Drug cartels care less about drugs. It's not about drugs, it's about money.
Yeah.
And money comes from human trafficking and sex slavery foremost. Internet crimes and identity theft, methamphetamine, cocaine, heroin, and then cannabis. So unless we're ready to have a very frank discussion about legalizing all the things, not only legalizing, but making them very cheap and in the reach of every single person very easily, we're gonna have problems. You know, already the mining industry is overtaken by the illegal industry. People don't talk, mining's legal, right? The worldwide tobacco industry, 2/3 of the cigarettes sold in New York are from black and gray markets, because they're taxed. And Britain is a huge number of underground. No one talks about the underground tobacco market, the underground mining market, logging. So I just don't think, I don't have, call me a pessimist, I'm not of the mind that by legalizing drugs, cannabis or even all of them, that these otherwise perfect angel drug dealers are now gonna become, you know, ice cream men because they're out of business. They're gonna adapt their business.
Now, I'm conscious that we may be of a similar view on this, so I'm going to be a little bit of a devil's advocate and say, well, hang on a minute. Four U.S. states have legalized marijuana, namely Alaska, Colorado, Oregon, and Washington. How have they got it wrong? Surely they haven't got it wrong. You're a lone voice in the ever-increasing debate and support for legalization.
Well, what's amazing is that we're the lone voice sort of financially, but every single major medical association and every single major national politician has said that they are not in favor of legalization. Now, there's this whole other issue of states' rights, and frankly, it's because we have a lot of, I don't know, states' rights is a big thing. And people say, I think we have a lot of trauma from that little incident that happened 250 years ago between our countries. And so we're obsessed with this idea, right, of free speech, which we should be, and states' rights. And so I think that has often clouded this whole discussion and debate, because it's ridiculous to say that what happens in Colorado doesn't affect Utah. Because not only does it affect them directly, they're transporting more cannabis out of Colorado than they ever have before. The numbers from the Postal Service are off the charts. But there is this little thing called the internet. And so kids in Kansas are reading about what's happening in Colorado. They're able to talk to the industry in Washington State who's planting the website saying that this is harmless. So, it's just, that's an amazing, amazing thing to me. I don't think they have it right. They have massive lobby special interests there that are overtaking the entire political process. And we're told by some well-meaning people in your country and also mine, Kevin, sit at the table and construct the regulations so that it doesn't go out of control. Why don't you, you can be there as part of framing what legalization looks like. Because really, Kevin, it's not about if, it's about how. So let's do it the right way. Well, let me tell you something. The industry could care less about what the American Public Health Association has to say, let alone what Kevin Sabet has to say about how to reduce the public health harms of a legalization policy. They care less because it is the only way they survive are for people to do this irresponsibly. So you know what? We did try and actually do. We after Colorado legalized, there were some people part of SAM even on the regulatory advisory group who shaped the regulations, and everything they said was shot down. They said plain packaging for jelly, jelly babies infused with THC. No, not gonna happen. Dosage controls. No, we didn't want that. Can we not have fluorescent grape and strawberry kiwi and orange pineapple so my 10-year-old isn't tempted? Oh, no, well, that's just what they are. We can't control that. Well, can we limit the THC so we don't have 98%, you heard me right, 98% THC waxes sold as butane hash oil to vaporize? Can we limit that? Can we regulate it to put a cap? Oh, no, well, that's not what the voters wanted. No, we can't do that. So let me tell you something. We tried to do that. And there are a lot of well-meaning people and academics out there that are saying, hold on, there are better ways to do it. I'm waiting for that better way to be funded with $10 million from the industry. It's not happening. So my thing is, you know, I'm not ignoring that this is and increasingly has a momentum, and I think it does. But I also think that there is an end point at some point, and possibly a reversal, mainly because I don't think that the average American or the average Briton wants to see jelly babies infused with THC sold next to the ice cream store they go to with their kids. I don't think they want to see the advertising on billboards and buses and all the things that they're seeing. And I invite you, please, hang out in Denver for a day and see what's going on. The homelessness increasing that we've been seeing, the other issues. On the ground, there's the mental illness. You know, you have done incredible work in the UK, and again, Robin Murray and his team and others, on high-potency cannabis and the direct link with psychosis and mental illness. It's just very groundbreaking what you all are doing here. We are looking at it with much interest and admiration. And I think that when these things come to a head, and it may take some time, I think people are going to say, wait a minute, we thought we were going to get tax money. We thought we'd be able to do this the right way. We sort of thought that it would be mainly for adults, but now we're seeing that that was all a lie. And just a final exclamation point on all of that, most people don't know that in Colorado, the majority of localities, 67% of cities, have banned the sales of cannabis outright. 84% of cities in the last election, 26 out of 31, banned the sales of cannabis outright. So it's sort of this not in my backyard issue as well, right? It's people who say like, oh yeah, in theory, let's get rid of the drug dealers and regulate. And then you say, oh, okay, well, we're gonna open a store right next to the, you know, post office that you go to with your, oh no, I don't want that, not there. Okay, well, we're gonna, you know, make sure that the next to your school there's advertising. Well, no, I don't want that. Do it somewhere else. And so we're seeing, I think, actually a growing backlash, maybe not among the 23-year-old Denver guy who moved there from Kansas and is in heaven smoking weed every day. But, you know, the mom, the dad, the voters, the people that are there that have families, I think they're seeing that they were sold this bill of goods that may not have been what they thought it was. We'll see if that happens.
But in addition to the four American states, and this is your sixth myth, the pro-legalization lobby would say, well, hang on a minute, we know that the Netherlands have a much more liberal approach towards smoking cannabis, and indeed Portugal. Why can't we make it work on those models?
One of the first trips we did at the White House was go to Portugal. And they said to us, please tell your people to stop saying that we have legalized drugs. We haven't. We have a small amount thing where you go and you see a panel. But we also, Kevin, no one's talking about, they said, the fact that we greatly increased treatment at the same time as well. People are just obsessed with this, what we've done with the law, and not what we've done with other things. So they were the ones who said to us that the world is misrepresenting Portugal. It's like when I hear, you know, billionaire heads of airlines that will remain nameless say, we need to legally regulate drugs. Look at how good Portugal has done. It's like, well, then, wait a minute, that's not what Portugal did. And by the way, the effects of Portugal's softening, because they have softened for individual use, I think they've been mixed. When you look at prevalence, actually prevalence has not gone down. Drug-related deaths have. Did drug-related deaths go down because they implemented treatment and sort of robust harm reduction, or did they go down because of decriminalization? I don't know. The point is, a lot is going on, and when you have the Cato Institute, which is a libertarian think tank that wants to legalize crack, come out and say, Portugal is the model. Well, I think we should be a bit suspicious and sort of look more at the data. And there have been academics that have looked at that data. Holland is very interesting. 40 years ago, we're celebrating the 40th anniversary this next year, celebrating is use the word loosely, of sort of liberalized laws in the Netherlands. You know, it's amazing. We were told when that happened, all of Europe is going to follow that example. You know, this is the way to go. It's sort of what we're hearing in the U.S. Like Colorado, the rest of the world is going to follow what's happening in Colorado and the U.S., right? Well, here we are 40 years later. I'm still waiting for a country to mimic the Holland, the Dutch model. They have not. Spain has some clubs that, you know, I don't know, these obscure clubs, and some other countries have some things that have sort of semi-legalized, but not to the extent of Holland. And you know, I think it's just, what is in the results in the Netherlands? I think they've been mixed. I think that when you look at the European data, the Netherlands is the number one country in Europe for demand of cannabis treatment. They're not number one for other drugs treatment, but they're number one for cannabis. I don't know if that's sort of exactly, we'll see if it's sort of directly related, but my point is, if it's such a success, why are they closing down coffee shops, which they are, right? Why isn't this widely, people say, well, they're closing it down because of the conservative government. Who elected the conservative government? I mean, if everybody wanted coffee shops, you'd elect people who were pro-coffee shop. That's not happening. So again, it sort of goes against this inevitability myth, which frankly should be an eighth myth, that this is inevitable, there's nothing you can do about it. They said it was inevitable when you guys downgraded, you guys, I'm not saying you, from B to C, right? They said, well, it's gonna become legal in a few years, this is the first step. And then actually, because of the mental health effects that you saw quite rapidly, and the research that's been published on this in Lambeth, they said, well, wait a minute, we're gonna reclassify it back to B. So that kind of, I just don't think it's this direct line going towards this inevitability of legalization, especially among a substance that's not used by the majority of people, and no one with a straight face can say, my family and my kids and my teachers and my students and my workers and my employees and my whoever are better off with more cannabis use. You can't say that with a straight face. So, we'll see.
Now, I'm conscious of time, but I just want to finish the seven myths, and I hope we're ending on a positive with this. The seventh myth is that prevention, intervention, and treatment are bound to fail. Yeah. Why should we try? You mentioned social justice. I hope you're going to give it as an answer on this.
Absolutely. Well, on the social justice bit as well, I mean, I hate to go back to the fifth myth, but I have to do it, or the fourth myth, on alcohol. Oh, wait a minute. The social justice, you know, I've seen the data out of out of Lambeth. I've seen the data out of Washington, D.C. and Baltimore, and I've seen the data out of Los Angeles, and I've seen the data in Dublin. Okay. When there are more places to buy liquor than a fresh piece of broccoli, right, in poorer communities, and that is the case in that area of South London, when it's the fact that in our ghetto, the United States, there are 8 times as many liquor stores than in upper-class communities, then let's have a discussion of social justice. Because people want to say, well, we need to legalize drugs because everybody's in prison and with social justice, the poor. We do need to reform our criminal justice policies. I'm all in favor of that, doing it in a smart way. But the idea that these industries somehow help social justice as opposed to target the most vulnerable among us, that's not what the evidence shows us. And when it comes to prevention, intervention, and treatment and recovery, you know, we forget about the fact that there are, frankly, tens of millions of people in the world, in the US alone, 24 million people, who are in long-term recovery from substance abuse. There's this culture of anonymity because of AA, and I understand that, and the culture of Alcoholics Anonymous and Narcotics Anonymous and that sort of thing, your identity being anonymous. But at the same time, we have to also remember that millions upon millions of people live productive lives who at one point lost all hope, right? Who at one point were written off by society. And we are told, oh, Kevin, people are going to always use drugs. So, you know what? Just why try? Well, imagine if we applied that logic to poverty, cancer, something else. People are always, this is always going to happen, so why try? You know, the war on poverty 50 years ago in the US, I hate to break it to you, we still have poverty in the US. But we would never say stop anti-poverty programs because there are still people that are poor. So we have to keep trying, and at the end of the day, there are far fewer people using illegal drugs than legal ones. So prevention does work, early intervention works, and treating it. Now, treating marijuana addiction is, I've been told by treatment experts, I mean, people who are clinical directors of the largest, for example, treatment center in Colorado, they dread treating cannabis addiction. And I said, well, wouldn't you dread heroin addiction? Because, you know, that can lead to death, and it's so much work. They said, no. We can treat heroin. We have medications, we have other things. We sort of, not that it's 100%, but with cannabis, there is so much denial from the individual, from the family, from society, that there's ever a problem. Because it often takes some time to show up. You know, you sort of think about the express train and the local train. The local train makes a lot of stops, but it gets to the destination. The express train goes straight there. In a sense, heroin and cocaine can be seen as the express train to addiction and problems. And for a lot of people, cannabis just doesn't seem that bad, especially in the beginning. You're sort of trotting along slowly, you're getting off, you're getting on, you're never gonna get there. But then at some point you get there and you're at the same place you were with heroin and cocaine. And I've had treatment directors scold me and say, Kevin, don't think that there's a difference in the people who are here with an addiction to heroin, cocaine, methamphetamine, or cannabis. Because they're at the same place. They're at a place of desperation and hopelessness and they need hope. It doesn't matter how they got here. They are different substances, but they got here to the same place that they're at, and that's why we're here to help them. So we have to invest more in treatment because, frankly, treatment for cannabis is hard. And it does work. It absolutely can work, but it needs to be taken seriously by government. We have to look at things like drugs courts, which I know there are a few. I know that you've dealt with it, frankly, this model of swift sanctions, but sort of compassion and treatment. You've dealt with it, I know, with this new court here, which I think is great. You had the event I saw earlier, I think it was last year, on it here, about for drink driving and heavy drinking. We need to expand that model here for drugs because this is something that is not perfectly suited to the criminal system and not suited only to the health system. It's often both. And so things like drugs courts, if it's done, implemented in the right way, I think can be that. But so I think we have all kinds of things that can work, even though we're told, you know, nothing works.
Well, that's a very positive note on which to end this part of the evening. And now I'd like it to open it up to the floor, please. If I may, I'm going to take three questions at a time. And I've been asked by those that have run these events before, please ask questions rather than speeches. So who would like to be our first question?
I'm James Gillis from Horrell, but speaking privately. Can I take you back to your breakfast? James Gillis from Horrell. Can I take you back to your breakfast? You talked about that second croissant. There's a lot of debate in this country at the moment about sugar taxation, right, about the ways in which the nanny state, yeah, sort of, dare I say, intervened. This is a very persuasive talk you've given, but I'm troubled that it's so persuasive that it could extend into other bits of the state's intervention in
sure.
people's lives.
Right,
anyone else? Second, at the back there,
and
then the gentleman with the
blue jeans. Tom Hackett. I'm wondering about the gateway element.
Sure.
In particular, is there not the danger that by banning cannabis,
sure,
you leave it in a situation where people buy it from the same people who sell illegal drugs?
Sure.
And similarly, isn't your model going down the route of the United States under prohibition, where it was perfectly legal to buy and people didn't get prosecuted, but it was illegal to sell? And isn't that the brilliant way of strengthening organised crime, where it's not illegal to buy from them?
And the gentleman there.
Thank you. My name is Billy Steele. I should first of all say that I myself am an alcoholic and addict. I drank for 30 years, I've been sober for 32 years. One of the things that I've discovered as a result of those 60 years' experience with drug addiction, cigarette addiction, certainly, and alcohol, is that it very much goes with the person as well as the substance. And I'm almost certain that I was born with the predisposition to alcohol and drugs, and any other drugs which I might have taken. I'm of an age whereby I never came across heroin and cocaine and stuff. They weren't around in those days to the extent that they are now. But I have little doubt that if I try heroin or cocaine, I become addicted to them as well. I don't believe that you can stop addiction, whether it's legal or illegal. But I do believe that treatment is possible, and I myself am living proof of that. And I just wish that, particularly in this country, that the medical profession and the National Health Service and so on would pay far more attention to the fact that without abstinence you cannot recover from any addiction. It's that simple. Once you're abstinent, you can then have a personality change, whereby, in the case of alcoholics anonymous and not 12-step program, you will stay sober. I'm just wondering whether you would agree with this, irrespective of whether it's legal or illegal.
Sure. Three very good questions. On the food issue, clearly there's a distinction between something required for survival, food, than something not required for survival, and actually something that unnaturally increases the pleasure center of our brain on the range, right? So there, I didn't mean to say that I'm not lumping food in with methamphetamine. Well, sometimes chocolate, you know, it's really, well, there's a pull, but in reality, of course not. And so I do think we should worry about this over, but I also think it's particularly ironic that we're worried about 16-ounce sodas, and we're at the same time figuring out what the, you know, the THC in the jelly babies, and should you be 18 or 19 or 20, and which color should it be, and we're legitimizing that. And so I that's particularly troubling. But I agree with you. I think that, you know, there is a line somewhere. At the end of the day, cheeseburgers don't change your behavior. That's what we're talking about. Biobehavioral disorder, right? Diet Coke makes you a bit more awake, but you probably won't have that craving so strong for that Diet Coke that you're going to lie to your entire family, not go to work, put your children in jeopardy, drive somewhere with a stranger to get the Diet Coke. So there is an absolute qualitative difference. At the same time, there's also the sugar lobby and all sorts of things that are also thriving off of the increase of their use. So there, you know, there's different ways in the models, but in terms of the perspective you were bringing, Nanny State, I agree, there is a qualitative difference between these two things. The second question was prohibition of gateway and then prohibition. So, you know, the gateway is really interesting. It's kind of a half glass, half full, half empty sort of thing. What do I mean by that? The vast majority of people who try cannabis will not go on to use heroin or cocaine. We know that. But we also know that 99% of heroin and cocaine users, methamphetamine, used cannabis first, along with alcohol. Okay. Why is that? So the interesting question isn't, is it a gateway? It's different. Going to the third gentleman's question. It is absolutely different for everybody. Okay. That's not the interesting question, because we know that most people don't, but then people who do are who start with it. The interesting question is, for those that do go on to it, what's the link? And that's what you were getting at. You were saying, is the link that they're interacting with drug dealers who say, all right, you know that cannabis thing, you gotta try this other thing. I think that is a bit of a mythology about how drug markets work. You know, kids don't buy cannabis from the shady dealer on the corner. They frankly get it from either their parents' stash these days, believe it or not, and oftentimes parents are introducing it to their kids because they're saying, I had a gentleman the other day say, well, I introduced cannabis to my 16-year-old. He only smokes it with me once a month, and that's my way of regulating it. And I said, really, I'm sure, in my head I was thinking, I was like, I'm sure he goes to his best mate and says, sorry, I can't smoke cannabis. It's not my day. I only do it with my dad. But this is sometimes the parents have this, it's unbelievable how parents think that the adolescent brain is the same brain as theirs. It's not. It's different. I'm not saying it's more stupid or more naive, but it is more naive. It is different. It hasn't fully developed. And so, really, kids are getting their cannabis not from the corner dealer. They're getting it from friends and siblings. This idea of you're interacting with the meth dealer if you use cannabis, maybe for some people that's a link in, but actually the more interesting research on why there's a connection is looking at biological issues in the brain. Are you priming your reward center when you use cannabis so much that eventually you want to go for a much greater high? That you're able, the toes in the water, you want to go for more? I have seen a great paper by Rob McCoon explaining like 15 different possible links with the reason why. And that's more of an interesting question. I think, and this goes with the gentleman's question, everyone is different. We all know that the person who smoked for 70 years and died of old age, right? I also know the person who smoked for 5 years and died of lung cancer. So, absolutely, the trick is, we don't know our DNA in that sense. You don't know if you're going to be predisposed to that or not. You can guess. There may be scientific techniques to help us. But we're not exactly sure. So, it is nature and nurture, I think, together. And the gentleman said it right. If there were cocaine and heroin more widely available to those of us who have an addictive personality, what is the impact going to be? That proves that availability has some role. I'm not saying it's the only role. I'm not saying we're going to make it so that cannabis is never available through prohibition. It will be available. We have to reduce the demand. But if we also reduce the availability, and it's a little harder to get, that actually helps people not use those drugs? I know there was a question on prohibition, but let me take that maybe afterwards, but we'll take any more questions.
Any other questions?
Some very interesting comments. It's a difficult subject. I'm interested in your experiences with trying to push an evidence-based policy forward. I'm particularly interested in your views as to what happened in the UK a few years ago with Professor Nutt, who was head of the Drugs Advisory Council, and published his own research, which suggested by his academic measure that the cannabis was less risky than both alcohol and tobacco. Secondly, I'll throw a quick question, being devil's advocate,
sure.
You know, drug may make you lighter your wife and your family, but so will an affair. And
not so will what?
An affair.
Yeah.
Adultery, you can't, we're not proposing to
prohibit
that. Any other questions?
Often it seems there's a general confusion about the difference between decriminalisation and legalisation. Sometimes they send people making an equation between the two. I wonder how problematic this is.
Do we have a third after the room?
Thanks to you. It's your left.
Harry Shapiro. It sounds, correct me if I'm wrong, but it sounds as if much of your work is predicated on trying to get the science across. And I mean, I've worked in drug information in the UK for over 30 years. And I, you know, I heard Nancy Reagan and Parents for a Drug-Free America and well-funded drug awareness resistance education, the DARE programs that were run by the police, all trying to make science simple, stuff put out by NIDA and the DEA and so on. And it does seem to me that because of what you've just said, that you know everybody's different, and everybody knows somebody who's, you know, you've smoked cannabis for years and they seem
right.
Fine, what's your problem? That's where the science falls down in terms of, you know, trying to get public information across. Whereas what you were saying about people realizing they might have a cannabis store next to the ice cream parlor and thinking, well, I don't want that. We've had that in this country with legal highs.
Right.
As soon as they started appearing in high street shops, people woke up to the fact that this was something they didn't really want. So I'm not sure whether the science route to get the message across is, you know, because people like Robin Murray, they only ever going to see the worst cases, and the consultant's a psychiatrist, you know. So I just wonder whether that is the most fruitful
route. Well, I'm going to answer in the reverse order, just because I don't agree with that. And so, you're right, it's difficult to sort of publicly make it easy to understand the nuance behind something like cannabis increases your risk for schizophrenia sevenfold, but the majority of people who smoke cannabis won't get schizophrenia. That is a difficult thing, but how do you explain it? It's hard. But we have done it with other things in a way. So smoking is linked to lung cancer. Well, you all know, actually, the research shows if you smoke a pack a day for something like 20 years, the majority of those people will not get lung cancer. It's shocking when you say that to people because they're like, what? I thought if you just live for like a year, that you're going to get... They're shocked at that. But of course, if you smoke a pack a day for 20 years, you've increased your chance for lung cancer 20-fold, right? If you don't wear your seatbelt and you get into a car crash, most people won't die. But that's not the public awareness campaign. The public awareness campaign is wear your seatbelt, because if you don't, there's a 10 times chance that you're gonna die. Don't drink and drive, because if you do, you've increased your risk of a fatal car crash 30 times. Well, the little truth in that matter too is that most people who drive drunk will not get into a fatal car crash, right? So how do you, so I think you're right, it's hard to do that nuance. I think you do have to go though and just make it simple by saying, look, there is a link. We're not saying this will happen to everyone, but you should know that there's a warning. Right now, with cannabis, unlike tobacco, we have the opposite movement. We have the movement saying, there's no link. There's nothing wrong. In fact, there's not only nothing wrong, it's beneficial. And so I think we have to change that to the other side of it. And
Given tonight we are, as I say, discussing the debating the psychoactive substances bill, which we've just been examining on the Home Affairs Select Committee, it seems to me that the argument we hear from a lot of young people is that they take legal highs because they're legal, and they think that must mean that they're safe. And every time I hear this, I think to myself, my goodness, how do the people who support decriminalisation or legalisation, how do you counter that? Because if you decriminalise marijuana or something stronger, then you're going to be sending the message to a lot of young people who perhaps don't read, you know, the newspapers as avidly as lots of people in here do, or they don't analyse the scientific data. They just get the block messages that come through. How are they going to, what are they going to think if we legalise cocaine? They're going to think it's legal, therefore it's safe. And that's an argument I personally haven't heard the pro lobby, if I may call them that, counter against that, argue against that. I don't know.
Well, I'll play devil's advocate. The way they counter against that is, wait a minute, tobacco is legal, and yet everyone thinks it's harmful. And of course, the counter to that, though, is it took us 150 years to get the research out to convince people not to, well, first to convince, because 130 years to convince people, you know, probably smoking around young people is not a good idea. Took us 80 years to say, probably smoking in a small capsule 30,000 feet in the air with wings and no oxygen is probably not a good idea. So you're right. We have adamantly a societal stamp against tobacco, which is legal. But guess what? It's not the legality that made us change our minds. That's my point. It's been legal forever. Right? What made us change our minds? About 100 million dead bodies. And so what I'm saying is, I don't know if we're going to have 100 million dead bodies and 100 years of cannibalization. No. What I'm saying, though, is I just hope we don't have to, you know, burn our entire hand off by the time we figure out that, whoops, the stove was hot. And that's really my worry about it. So, and then you brought up decriminalization. Should I mention that? So, I hate the term decriminalization. Can I just say that now? It's late at night, it's a long day, we're letting loose. I really don't like the term. And I don't like the term because it's used and misused left, right, and center from both advocates, the media, the worst. When Colorado legalized marijuana, which meant that you could sell jelly babies in a store to anyone over 21, the headline was, cannabis decriminalized in Colorado. I thought we knew the difference, because everyone here probably understands decriminalize, you remove criminal sanctions, you don't necessarily legalize the use or production. So we should say that's sensible. People should understand. That's a good joke. They don't. Nobody does. And so I think it's harmful. But the actual policy, if you were to say, okay, fair enough, well, what do you think if we could agree on a definition which you say society will never, fair enough, but in this room we can agree, you just remove criminal penalties, what do you think about, or remove the criminal element, what do you think? I think also, it's still not a good term to use, even if you agree, because there are different versions of removing criminal penalties, right? You essentially, in a sense, people are not getting criminal records, in my understanding, in the UK for smoking a joint, but there is a message that it's illegal, it's dangerous, it's harmful, there's treatment, there's early intervention, there's counselors. And so, what is that policy? Is it decriminalization? Well, I don't know, because it looks very different than when Alaska decriminalized 10 years ago, which allowed them to grow 20 plants in their backyard. You know, so, I mean, there are these huge variations, not only between decrim and legal, which people tend to ask, is there, but also between what actually is the policy. So my thing has been, forget the labels, define the policy you're talking about. And in terms of what I'm in favor of, this goes to the gentleman's other question about prohibition here, what I'm in favor of is not sending the message that this is decriminalized, it's no problem, this is no big deal, but actually saying, this is dangerous, we don't want you to use it, especially when your brain is growing. And you know, if you do, we're not gonna throw you in prison and make sure you pay for life, but we're gonna see if you have a problem, because if you're getting cited 10 times and you're paying a fine, 10 times in a year, maybe there's something going on, maybe there's a mental illness issue, let's assess you and figure it out. Maybe there's a treatment issue. Maybe you need some kind of early intervention. Maybe you just need a place to go to after school. Maybe you need a better education. Maybe you need a job. I mean, we need to, this is why none of this falls so easily. Well, what, you always say, well, Kevin, you haven't articulated. What do you exactly want to happen to the person who is smoking cannabis? Well, When someone says that to me, I have 10 questions for them. How old are they? Public, private, first time offense, 10th offense, crime involved, not involved, other drugs involved. I mean, this complexity of each time it happens means that we have to have, I think, a more complex response than, well, just decriminalize the law. The first question I can't
remember. And then the first question was about evidence-based policy and David Nutt of the Drugs Advisory Council, and then a tweak in the tail about affairs.
Tweak in the tail? Good luck with that. I think that obviously Professor Nutt has had a distinguished career, and I think it's wonderful, but I think that making some classification. This is worse than that, which means we got to treat this different than that, is like saying something like, we have 10 floors in this building. It's much worse to jump out of the 10th floor than the 6th floor. Well, what does that mean? Does that mean you should jump out of the 6th floor? Well, no, but that's the impression that's given when this kind of research gets out there and frankly twisted. And also, the main reason I think it's not, I think Robin Murray had a great description of it that David Raines in the back, who's done such great work on this for 40 years, can tell us, remind us of the quote. But it's a futile exercise because drugs affect people differently. Tobacco is absolutely the most addictive drug. What does that mean? Can we legalize tobacco because it's more addictive than heroin? Or, I mean, legalized heroin, sorry, is more addictive than tobacco. Well, I don't know. Tobacco, though, does not affect your performance at school. And I hope there are no kids watching this. It might help because we know how it affects concentration. We don't want to talk about that. Because it kills a lot of people. We don't want to talk about that. But seriously, and alcohol destroys your liver. What does it do to your lungs? Well, nothing. It's nothing like alcohol. So what is the implication from that? Is that the media and other people get to say, well, this is worse than that, and the aggregate of this and that, and so we should treat this worse than that, and it doesn't take into effect cultural factors. Look, alcohol is absolutely one of the worst, but it's here to stay at 7,000, because before the Old Testament, the majority of the Western culture has drank. Yeah, but the thing is, we can reduce the harms, but I just think these have very different harms, and I really dislike in America how we have said, what's worse, alcohol or pot? I don't know. Are you talking about psychosis? Pot. Are you talking about liver damage? Alcohol. Are you talking about violence? Probably alcohol. But let me tell you, there's been a lot of violence related to hypotensive marijuana that we don't want to talk about. Combined with our really bad gun laws. That's for the next one. So I just think that is, we sort of mix things up. And the thing about adultery does affect other people, absolutely. But I don't pay in my taxes for, I'm not going to say door adultery, you brought it up. And I don't have to drive a car. If you're an adulterer and you're driving next to me, good on you. Well, as long as you're not drinking something proper in the car. That analogy. But my point is, it doesn't affect your intoxication. So people say, they love to say, well, Kevin, this is just like same-sex marriage. It's been legalized everywhere as a human right. I know, it's great. So cannabis legalization, following the same thing. I don't care if my bus driver is in a same-sex relationship. I do care if she smoked cannabis that morning. So I think we conflate these things.
Can I just very quickly just come back to Paul, really interesting what you think whether what the UK government did in terms of removing him as head of the Drugs Advisory Council was appropriate.
I'm not going to comment on one country to the other. I have a lot of respect for Les Iverson and the other people. Sarah Graham couldn't be here, who's on it. I frankly think that, saying something like that MDMA is, even though scientifically it might be true, is safer than riding a horse. Maybe I've answered your question accidentally. Sorry, it is late. We should close it up before it gets worse. But I think that is irresponsible because people are going to take that in one way than the other. And you know what? It's not a 50-year-old professor listening to that person. It's a 12-year-old kid who listens to it on television. And I think that is where scientists and politicians sometimes are totally out of reality in terms of the context of the actions that they're taking. Thank you.
A very interesting discussion. I'd just like to thank you both and to say if you'd like to hear more about this important topic,
You mentioned your site earlier on. Learnabout.sam.org is a great resource which you could all look at afterwards and see the tremendous amount of research that you've compiled there. If you'd like to hear more about Policy Exchange's work on this important topic, my name is Ken Gaskell, so I should more appropriately introduce myself at the start. I head up the Crime and Justice Unit at Policy Exchange. I'm delighted to hear from any of you on this topic or others in my subject area. We have some drinks at the back, and I think you can probably have one or two, I think, when we're sharing away at the start.
We had a lot of comments on email, and it's not like my
But I would just like to thank Victoria and Kevin for the very interesting discussion. Can we show our appreciation?